welcome to another episode of the Rebel Podcast, coming to you from the Balcony of Freedom on this Sunday afternoon in sunny Melbourne. My name is Prefontaine, and I'm joined once again for the first time in quite some time by my two co-hosts. I would say regular, but a podcast isn't regular if you have a two-month gap or almost that. Anyway, welcome back on here, my brother Fraaank. How are you?
Hail, Pre.
And Callum, welcome back.
Hey, Gun.
So here we are to talk about the Rebel Podcast and talk about the football club that we love, Celtic. I think we should... Well, first of all, let's just be honest here. Who, Callum, did you watch this morning / last night's demolition of Inverness Kelly Thistle?
I did not. It wasn't on Satanta.
And Fraaank?
No, it wasn't on.
Right, okay. So nor did I.
Some First Division game was on.
Really?
Yeah.
They were showing the Huns?
Yeah.
What division are they in?
I think it's first, isn't it?
Are they in the second?
It's changed now. I don't know what it is.
Okay, just go back to the...
No, because Premier League, they call the championship the next league, and then First Division, Second Division.
I hate when they do that. So it's the old...
It's the old APL. Third Division.
The old Third Division.
Yeah.
Okay. So in the easy, we have the Premier Division, Division 1, 2 and 3.
Yeah.
And 4.
Years and years ago, it was just 1, 2, 3.
Yeah, it was 1, 2, 3. Okay, so it's whatever. Anyway, they're not in our division. Right. Didn't watch it, though, did you?
No.
No.
I wish I had.
Did they lose?
No.
Oh. Why did you wish you watched it?
I thought we were talking about Celtic.
Oh, right. No.
I'm not talking about the Huns. Who gives a shit?
Right, anyway. So none of us have watched it. And I actually wanted to talk about that. The fact that we haven't watched it, and there's a fair few games I've missed this season, and the fact that we haven't been doing podcasts.
There's probably a lot of games both of you blokes have missed.
I did watch...
Ever since the European games where you get kicked out, you have dropped the ball.
Well, I just think that's important that we have this conversation and accuse each other of being part-time supporters, because that's...
Well, as long as you two have accused yourself, that's fine.
That's what Celtic supporters are really good at, on Twitter.
On Twitter.
Yeah.
You win a game 5-0, and how much abuse does bloody the coach get, the manager get, Lee Griffiths get...
Yeah.
And you two blokes hang shit on each other.
Well, no.
What is your reason, anyway? What is your excuse for dropping the ball there?
I haven't dropped the ball. It is true that I have missed games this season. I think I've probably not seen... I certainly have not watched any games live. Well, I've watched a few games live, just simply because the times have been bad, but I've then got on the next day and watched it on Celtic TV.
But in years gone past, that would never happen.
Probably not, no. But
why is that?
I'm getting older.
I'm busy. I've been really busy.
Well, you're definitely not older, so that cuts you out. You're bloody...
I went to watch the Aberdeen game. I set my alarm for 6:45 in the morning a couple of days ago.
There is no chance of you ever getting up at that time in the morning.
So I had to go to work, and then it was just... I got up and I went...
Well, I got up and watched that game. And it was a good game.
Mm.
The other problem is, Dad, every time I come home from uni or work, you're already watching the game.
Halfway it's been
through.
Sitting there for 4 days.
So you can't
still haven't watched
home?
It.
Can't wait till I get home.
Anyway, I've watched most of the games.
Well, good on you, mate.
And
I'm a lot older than you, so that's no excuse being older.
Right. Okay. So do tell us.
No, but what I'm saying is, you know, I reckon that is to do with the league. It's all but over.
In the back of my head, that is a nagging thought. I have to be honest.
Yeah.
So would you want the Huns back in the team?
No. No, I just want a more competitive league.
And that's up to the other teams.
Yeah.
Anybody. Not any particular team, just any team.
Yeah.
And if you look at the league, it's the most even it's ever been. Like this morning, there was a couple of results which meant that apart from one team, Hearts, every other team still has a chance of getting in the top six.
Yeah.
That's sensational for those teams as an even across the board. Like, you know, Aberdeen drew this morning.
Yeah.
And no doubt they took the foot off the pedal after they got points against us.
Yeah.
But that's the first time we've slipped up.
Yeah.
But every other game in the league, you know, games can go any way. Like, I was looking about 7 games ago, Inverness were actually second.
Yeah.
And right on our hammer.
Yeah.
Now, they'll be lucky to stay in the top six.
Yeah.
Because they may have got like 6 or 7 points out of the last 10 games.
Yeah.
But that's what's happening. Everyone's so even on any given day.
Except for us.
Yeah.
In which we're now 9 points away from winning the title.
Yeah, that's not our fault. It's
no.
As someone said, what was the quote this morning? We're going flat out up a down stairwell, an automatic stairwell. So we're not treading water, but
yeah,
it's hard work.
Yeah.
Hard work, and we're still 20 points ahead, anyway.
So after the after getting knocked out of both domestic cups and losing to Aberdeen on the weekend, I noticed, well, I've sort of noticed it over the course of the last couple of weeks, that the Lennon haters are coming back to the surface again, saying that, well, someone on Twitter even said that he's never ever won any games where there's been any pressure. I was like, what? And but even before I could respond, three or four people had said, Barcelona.
any of the European listeners off games at the start,
yeah,
the start of the season.
Yeah, qualifiers.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's pressure. And even the days when the Huns are around, those games are the pressure cookers there. And he did win, and the team did win. But do you think is there any justification for the criticism levelled at Neil Lennon?
Only when we don't play well, and he doesn't seem to have any other ideas other than what he's got. So when we got knocked out of the cup, when we lost against Aberdeen, it was I'd demolish games. But from what I read on Twitter, people were saying, the argument was he doesn't have a plan B.
Yeah,
and he puts all his eggs in one basket, and he puts all his faith in players that have shown him, you know, good faith over the years. But George Samaras has not had a good year.
No.
James Forrest hasn't had a good year at all. And he said, the argument was that he's giving these players the opportunity, or continues to give them the opportunity to keep playing, and yet not giving the under-19s or the reserve team any chance at all to get on the first team.
Yeah.
Which he just made some noise last week saying that when they win the league, they'll have a number of games. They'll do what they did last year, which was rest players before the Champions League games, which is a good idea. Because we've also got a World Cup at this as well, which will mean that there's less break for a lot of these guys.
Yeah.
But you just do wonder why some of the younger kids aren't getting any go at all. Yeah. You know, and continue to stick with what if the system doesn't seem to work all that well.
Frankie?
Well, the criticism comes when we lose, obviously. And, you know, losing Aberdeen in the cup and then losing again a couple of weeks later in the league. I mean, okay, we were never going to win every game in the league.
No.
That's impossible. So on any given day, one team, and it looked like it was going to be either, you know, Aberdeen lately, was going to do that. And if you've seen the goals that they scored, I mean, mine was a crack.
Yeah.
You know, wouldn't have mattered who was in goal.
Yeah.
It didn't matter. That was a goal. And the next one was just that bloody slack marking,
yeah,
which, you know, we've covered up with the two guys who've played so well consistently. Yeah. Admittedly, they haven't had much to contend with outside the European, but, you know.
Still have to do a job.
Yeah, that's right. The problem was getting kicked out of the Scottish Cup. That broke the...
That hurt because, as well, the finals would be played at Celtic Park.
Yeah.
And that's...
And everyone's a party. And also in the back of their minds, I think, everyone's thinking there's an outside chance we might come up against Sevco at some point if both teams continue to... Mm. Well, it will happen. It would have happened if both teams continue to win and progress through the tournament. Yep. And I think there's a bit of forward-thinking pride that's been dented. Because now there's a chance that Sevco could play in a Scottish Cup.
There's no chance that's going to happen. But anyway, so the Scottish Cup was more disappointing, you know, losing that, especially winning 1-0. I mean,
is a cup traditionally that Celtic have done very well.
Yeah, at home, and they just played so poorly. But I, you know, watching the replay, they did enough to win. It was just one of those days they just couldn't score.
Yeah.
You know.
You don't think Aberdeen's got our measure? They've sort of worked us out a bit?
That's what I'm saying. That's what the criticism is.
Yeah, and the lineup. He keeps playing two in the middle, whereas Aberdeen have got two ex-Celtic players in the middle plus two other guys helping out.
Yeah.
So four against two is always going to win in that situation. But that's the players. The players are not doing what Lennon wants.
Mm.
You know, if you're playing two wingers, like our left and right backs, and they're not pushing up and helping, then surely our midfield's going to get beat every time.
Yeah.
And we should be pushing up because they don't play three up front, they play one up front.
Yeah.
So we've got two guys outside left and outside right backs who are not doing anything.
Yeah. And I noticed that in the second half, Celtic played better, but I think Aberdeen allowed Celtic to play better. They kind of went into the sheds at half-time, Aberdeen, and said, right, 2-0, that's enough. Let's just shut up shop now and just take what we've got from this. And that's why Celtic had so much possession. But I just didn't think that we had that that cut, a killer, sort of, not even just a killer ball, but just those kind of balls that were played a little bit quicker to then just take two or three defenders out and then create space to score. And that's the goal that we scored. It was like playing drafts, you know, or chess, having to move around the penalty box with five passes.
Yeah, Forrest took it really well. Mm. I mean, great pass from Scotty Brown.
Yeah.
Great lead-up play on the right. It was almost like a European move where you had to be clinical with the 1-2 pass.
Yeah,
they should be, though, against these teams.
They should be, yeah, that's right.
The problem, where the Lennon haters fall down in their discussion about Lennon and how they don't like his tactics and things, they pick certain games. They pick the game at Ibrox when we could have won the league a couple of years ago. They pick the league Cup final. They pick, you know, this Aberdeen game. These games have all happened, you know, once, or you know, they've all happened over the last four or five years. There's no consistency in, clearly the team's playing well, clearly we've done well. We've done a lot better than what we haven't done.
Yeah,
we've won the league. We've progressed in Europe. We've got good players in. So where their argument falls down is, he consistently does the wrong thing and consistently doesn't change it up and consistently we're playing poor. Well, that's not true. You can't just pick four instances over 4 years.
Yeah.
We're never going to have a perfect season. It's never going to happen.
You're talking about 250 games.
Yeah. So that's where they really do fall down and they don't seem to see that. Because this will burn in their minds, is the Aberdeen game for the next. Lennon could win the Champions League, honestly, and some of these people will, in 10 years' time, go, oh, it's, you know, just an odd good manager.
Yeah.
You know? The other thing is, he's still young, he's still plying his trade.
Hmm.
What other managers out there right now, let's be honest, would go to Celtic? We want these top quality managers. What managers right now in the market would be going to Celtic who's young enough, who can, you know, he's got a proven track record? Without all the competition in the league. Champions League, I understand that. That's where it comes from. But if you get knocked out before Christmas, like what happened before Europe...
Actually, that's a good question. Because before Lennon was appointed, they were talking about all these younger guys in the Premier League. And none of them were interested.
Mm.
None of them
were interested. Mowbray, that's who was interested.
Yeah, and that's when there was two teams in the league. Yeah, that's when the Rangers were there.
Mm.
So none of those guys are interested. It's not their cup of tea. It's about the money. It's about the prestige of that league.
But and for these guys, for the guys that come, you see exactly what's happened to Manchester United with Moyes. You get these guys who they've done okay, but none of them know how to win at managing. They don't know how to win consistently. And there's actually, even though some of these managers would go, oh, well, I could win. There's pressure on winning every week.
Mm.
There's not pressure in the Premier League for teams from 4 to 15. All they have to do is stay. That's all they have to do is stay up. That is all they do and maybe do a good a cup run.
Mm.
Whereas exactly what happened to Mowbray, he comes to a team where he played for us, never won. Comes and needs to win games.
And he should have understood it more than anyone.
Well,
he couldn't.
Yeah, but he couldn't because he didn't play in a winning Celtic team anyway.
Mm.
But that's the other problem. There's the added pressure which. A lot of these managers don't want to face because, especially in a two-team, well, now a one-team city, their name's going to be on the paper every day.
Yep.
And that's the thing that they don't want. It's in the, you know, a lot more money coming 10th in the Premier League than, you know, I'm not worrying about it.
The guy that writes for eTeams was... I actually don't mind reading his stuff most of the time, but after the game last week, he got the claws out again and...
Mm.
And some of the stuff is what you're saying. And it's just, it's not really called for it because it's so negative. Everything about it is so negative, what you're saying about, picking out certain games. And you read it and you go, oh, I just can't. Yeah? So you don't read that.
Yeah.
You don't read that article or that, you don't read eSims for a week.
Yeah. I must admit, I've stopped reading eSims altogether.
Because it's just, it's good when it's actually good
it
for a
funny.
Laugh.
Yeah, it can be very funny.
Yeah. Only if things are going all right.
Mm. It does get you down reading constantly negative things. You go, oh my God, I can't bother anymore.
Yeah.
Do you think that Neil Lennon... There's obviously some reports in the papers last week that Lennon is off. He's away to, you know, England, which, you know, we always... That happens every year for anyone who's doing quite well. This is kind of the media's default when Celtic are doing well and up. Let's write things to create instability within the club or the support. So there was articles that came out about Lennon wanting away. Do you guys buy into that? Do you think that's the case? Will he still be managing Celtic at the start of next season?
Yes.
Yeah, there's no debate about that, really.
I think he will move on, absolutely. And that's...
Yeah.
And Gordon Strachan did say his rule, every 3 years a manager should move on or something.
Which I don't agree with that.
No, I don't. Well,
no. Look at Alec Ferguson.
Well, more, yeah, the bigger figure, Kevin Sheedy.
The former defender for Everton.
Yes.
Who did he manage? Yeah.
Does that team actually exist anymore? I'm not sure. I think they were taken out by a drug scandal.
Everton.
No, this is going over every person who listens to us right now.
Yeah. We have people.
Well, we could talk about the cricket.
We could. How are we going with the cricket?
Good. We'll talk about that later, though.
Oh, good. Right. Let's.
Well, what did you think about Lennon going?
Yeah, no, I don't think it's happening.
No.
No.
We all like Lennon here.
Yeah, we're all pro Lennon.
Is it pro Lennon or pro Lennon?
Yeah, what's with Nicholas and Elka? What a hit case.
I tweeted that and there were some random Sonic fans who went, oh no, he was just, you know,
kidding or sore arm.
Yeah, sore arm, that's right.
Like,
pointing at the
I've never heard of that. The reverse salute, have you?
No, I had when he first did it a while back, and I ended up reading Wikipedia. It's a wonderful thing. I ended up going. Like,
Wikipedia's your friend.
Yeah, I really.
You got really deep into it.
I got deep.
Yeah, you can.
I got way deep. All of a sudden, I was on bloody Combat 33 fucking websites and looking up all sorts of shit. The Australian Intelligence Security Agency knocked on my door saying, do you have any sort of far right tendencies that we need to know about?
Well, you're saying that because the AFP were downstairs last night.
Oh, were they?
At a little bar. That's a good little bar downstairs.
Yeah.
It's expensive, but it's like a nice little place to have a beer. And they had their earphones in, just two of them sitting there.
Right.
So did you come across the ex-goalie?
Which one?
What's his name? Does Fox Sports?
Mark Bosnich. That's right, because he did a Nazi salute at when he played for...
He stopped doing that.
Spurs.
At Spurs. Yeah, he was playing for Villa, I think it was.
Yeah, or Man United.
Yeah.
The same game that he pretended to do a line of cocaine on the...
No, that was...
That was Robbie Fowler.
Yeah.
Oh, that Fowler?
Mm. Yeah, had to be a big line with that nose, though.
Yeah. He sucked up pretty much the whole penalty box. And then played really well afterwards. Scored a couple more goals.
Was last seen running down the road trying to get the corner flag out of his nose.
Let's talk about some players this season for Celtic that have been standouts. You've gone, I'm happy about the development of this player in this season.
Chris Commons, £300,000, player of the year.
Yep.
Only played 20 minutes last night.
Yep.
Got rested, so yeah, he'll go down as the best player this year, without doubt. Came on and scored.
Yep.
Again.
He's done all the right, you know, we all thought. And I still think Joe Lilley is a Celtic guy, but he's done all the right things for Celtic. He stopped playing international football. You know, he's stuck around when other players have left, and he is the quality part of that. He is the quality bit of our team.
Yep.
So good on him.
Yeah. When we've spent money all around the bloody place trying to buy a forward, he's consistently kept scoring goals for us.
Yeah. Well, he's our leading goal scorer.
To the point where no bookie would take a bet on him for first goal. It was a given.
I know. That's nuts, isn't it? Near a bit on for me.
All right.
He hasn't obviously had the full season playing, but
he's a weird looking bloke, though.
He is a weird looking
bloke. We've got some weird. I don't like the.
It's an ugly team photo, isn't it?
We are going ugly.
Yeah. When Rhebel Phodcast, it's actually embarrassing when Rhebel Phodcast played for us, let's be honest.
I know.
We had Niall, Willow.
Yeah.
And
do you think that Neil Lennon, when he approached the board before the transfer window and says, gentlemen, we're going ugly for the second half of the season?
Well, they agreed, except they said, well, you need one golden boy, and that's why they got Pookie.
Yeah, Pookie.
He can't play, but he's not bad looking.
He's a good looking bloke.
Yeah.
My Van Dyke.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's actually close between those three.
He'd be close between him, yeah.
Yeah. And your selection, because he didn't get a run consistently, Bitong, is probably behind the eight ball, but it goes Commons, well, to me, Commons, Van Dyke, maybe Bitong.
Or Ambrose, maybe.
I'm not saying that Bitong is like player of the year capable. I'm just saying that he's a player that I've looked at in the last
month
or so, and I've gone, shit, you're good.
Do you know he's 6'5"?
Yeah. He's tall.
As weird as he looks, he's still big, you know, that standard. They've bought that 23-year-old, 6'5", can run, play in a couple of positions.
Yeah. Like, I know they're going to, like, when we win the league and they do rest players, I don't want to see him getting rested. I want to see him playing full 90 minutes.
He needs to play, yep. And that guy from the guy got rested this morning, got injured 2 weeks ago. Left footer.
Where's he play?
Midfield. We just bought him. He needs to play the rest of the games.
I really want to know who this is. What's his name? He's a midfielder. Central or on the wing?
From Denmark. Central midfielder.
Johansson.
Johansson, yeah. I reckon he's going to be good.
Yeah.
He looks the way he plays, right. He looks hard and he can pass the ball.
Yeah. Which, he's like the better version of Scott Brown. Because he can pass the ball. Yeah. Although Brownie's been playing well.
He has been playing
well. That was the other thing one of the guys said, Brown needs a rest.
Oh, fuck that.
Why? He's the captain of Celtic. Yeah. Why would you rest the captain of Celtic?
Yeah.
That's imagine you go up to Billy McNeil. Billy, you need a rest.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
I'm not doing that.
Yeah. And so for K6, you've been cup failed.
This rotation system's bullshit.
I just knew it. I'd worked it out 4 months back. I knew it was going to happen on this date. I saw the 25th of May and I thought, oh, if we go all the way, that's when I get rested. Yeah, that's just bullshit. Very good.
Back in the day, the Australian cricket selectors would have done that.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Before Boof. BB.
Callum, you've written here on the running sheet, planning for next year. Goals, question mark. Champions League, question mark. Tell us about that.
No, that's to you for that side discussion.
Oh, right. Well, I don't know what you wanted. Okay, planning for next year. Goals, Callum.
What are the objectives for next year?
Well, they clearly needed to buy someone who can score goals.
Yep.
After buying several players who were development players. I don't know what that means, but £1 million for the big Baldy, and he's had probably about 40 minutes full total football this year.
Which have all been 40 games that have been 1 minute each.
Yeah. And he scored a few goals too.
Which
someone was twittering it, what, live as a game winner, like he came on.
Yeah.
Right, game over. Here he comes.
Yeah. He's like a pinch hitter.
Yeah. But this morning's news with Lee Griffiths getting a hat-trick.
Yeah.
You know, all of a sudden, everyone's... You know, Celtic supporters should be saying, well, you know, we've finally got a poacher.
Yeah.
You know, someone who can take over of Hooper. The question mark is, can he do it in Europe?
Yeah.
And we won't know.
We didn't know about Hooper either.
That's right. Good time to actually find out with the qualifiers, unfortunately, to go through that. But,
yeah,
that opposition, he should eat them up.
Did young Anthony Stokes play today?
He did.
Yeah.
But he got taken off 60 minutes. 60
he can
minutes.
Honestly fuck himself.
I know you're not a big fan, Callum, of Tony Stokes. But I wonder if the introduction of Lee Griffiths into the side has meant that Stokes has become a better player. Because I think they play closer together than, say, him and Sammy.
That's fine. He needs to score still.
Well, he scored a hat-trick the other week.
Yeah. That was the first time he scored in a while, though.
Like,
he's still consistently. That's the thing.
Yeah.
But they need to figure out, before the qualifiers, what is the best pairing with Griffiths.
Just think back to the first season when there was Tony Stokes and Hooper.
Mm.
Those two were in a race to see who could score the most goals. Mm-hmm. And it was competitive. Stokes. So the point I'm trying to make is Stokes can score goals.
I don't
now
don't at all.
Clearly, he's not being. I don't think he is good enough at a European level, and he even when
his stats European wise are really bad.
No, they're not great. But I'm actually just thinking when we did play in Europe the season that him and Hooper were scoring a lot of goals. Stokes actually didn't play many of those games. We just played with one up front,
Sammy.
No, that's not true. Because I went through some of those stats and Stokes did play quite a few games.
He did last season. He played all of them.
But he's not. He just...
This season, right?
But actually, I was going to agree with you because every time the Europeans came up, he'd play, but he'd only get a bit of the game or sub.
Yeah.
And that stuffs up that, you know, consistency and that confidence thing. And, you know, the team would come in with Sammy.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, Sammy would be the European pick.
Yeah.
And it can't be good for that partnership, I reckon.
No.
One of the other problems was that he was then given an opportunity to play in the Champions League, and it was, you know, this is your one opportunity. And he really was given one opportunity to play, like a game.
Yeah, and it was a full game. Against Barcelona. Or
yeah, how much pressure is that on someone?
Up front by himself.
Yeah. So that's an issue as well.
There's a helicopter about to crash into the balcony for him.
It's coming right out.
It is. Turn! Thank you. Yeah, that microphone is literally talking to your penis right now, Callum. Yes, okay, so what I'm getting at is I'm thinking that you really need to tighten that nut, and I'm talking about the microphone.
You break it. It's gone. It's going to break it.
My hand is really sore.
You want me to do it?
There you go.
I just wonder if you could, if it turns out that Stokesy and Griffiths play quite well together for the remainder of the season, would you be able to manage that in Europe? But I just don't think Neil Lennon's going to play with two out front in Europe. So let's just, I guess it's a moot discussion.
Yeah, I don't know.
Maybe we just see how it works. And it's good that it's happening now, you know, giving them a chance to gel and things.
Yeah. Yeah.
So what's going to happen to Sammy?
I think, I don't know how much is left on his contract, but
this is it.
I think he's just going to go. I don't think
they're just phasing him out, aren't they?
Yeah, I don't think he's going to get a they may offer him.
They have offered him up. But it's same as Lily, they've offered him that's been on the table and they're not.
Yeah.
I think it's minimum wage.
Yeah. If only the staff at the Celtic shop could get that as well.
Yeah, that's right.
The living wage.
The living wage. Yeah, I think Sammy's going to go.
So no one could get any money for him.
I think in the back of his mind he's going, okay, I'm going to go to the World Cup, play for Greece on the international stage. Agent's going to be around there. The back of the box is going.
Do you know why isn't his agent fighting harder to get a better? If he's not happy with the terms and conditions, why isn't his agent fighting harder? There's a negotiation there.
Yeah. Well, maybe that is happening.
I mean, Sammy's just come through the best period of his playing career at Celtic. You know why? I'm not pro Sammy. If he leaves, I'm not that.
Yeah.
But you know, when he does play well.
Yeah. He's looked very disinterested this season.
Yeah. That's the Greek in him, isn't it?
Those dirty, dirty wogs.
All right, then. Okay, let's talk about... It's the anniversary of Bobby Sands going hungstrot now. It's the anniversary of...
That was on again the other day, too.
Hunger?
Yeah.
That is a really... You can't watch that movie more than once.
It's horrible, isn't it?
When I look at Michael Fassbender now...
Imagine if it was true.
I look at Michael Fassbender now and I just think Bobby Sands. So I went and saw 12 Years a Slave.
Oh yeah.
And it's clearly not Bobby Sands.
Yeah, and I said to the person I was with,
is that same guy?
Yeah.
Hang on, which role did he play?
The white
The owner.
Yeah.
Far, he was fantastic.
So I turned to cousin Fiona halfway through the film and I said, geez, that Bobby Sands is a bit of a cunt, isn't he?
Did she do the McArdle thing and just agree with you in it?
No, she did the McArdle thing, that's not funny, whilst pissing herself laughing. And it was a really bad time to do it because...
God.
Yeah, she's laughing.
Schindler's List.
She's like, hello.
She was making out.
Exactly. She's laughing through a bloody slave film. And I was going, don't laugh. But that Bobby Sands is a fucking kind of a bloke.
So you enjoyed it, did you?
It was a good film.
It was a good film, wasn't it?
It was a brilliant film.
Who's going to win the Oscar? Have you seen all the movies?
Yep.
You seen Wolf?
Yep.
Did you like it?
I thought it was an excellent 90-minute film that went for 3 hours.
Yeah, it was long, wasn't it?
It was too long. I didn't think it was a great film. I thought it was okay. I don't think it should win anything.
Have you seen American Hustle?
Yep.
Did you like that one?
No, overrated. There was it lacked hustle. Plenty of Americans, not a lot of hustle.
I didn't realise we had a movie section in this. It's not a bad idea, though.
Yeah, it is, actually.
Did you like Jennifer Lawrence in American Hustle?
I did. She was brilliant.
I thought her and Bradley Cooper were the only...
Oh, Bradley... I could just watch Bradley Cooper's perm the whole fucking film.
Yeah. Yeah, I thought Newcastle was okay. I thought it was okay. I don't think it was like what you were overrated or whatever you were saying.
Yeah.
I thought it was okay.
Oh, it was funny.
Yeah.
It was the repartee between him, Bradley yeah. Cooper, and Louis CK yeah. was priceless.
Oh, he's in, is he?
Yeah. yeah. Great.
He's his copper.
He's the chief. He's the commissioner. Or he's the guy. He's his boss. His boss. And Bradley Cooper. But Louis C.K. takes out almost like a restraining order and a harassment against Bradley Cooper, who is his underling, because he's harassing him so much to get more money out of him to pay for more sort of set up heists and stuff.
Oh,
it was very funny. It was very, very funny. A little subplot.
And there. You didn't like Gravity at all.
Oh, yeah. Gravity was just crap.
Did you not appreciate the visual effects of it?
Yeah, oh, yeah, that's fine. You can visual effects the fuck out of a film, but if the actual acting and the actual narrative of the story is pish, then I might as well just go to IMAX.
You knew she was in the movie. Why did you go and watch it?
Yeah, exactly. Sandra Bullock cannot act. And she's got that much bloody collagen pumped into her face now that she...
No expression.
She's just got one expression for the whole film, and it's not because she was in zero gravity. It's because there was Botox in her face.
So it doesn't matter what... What situation you put her on? Put her in a bus? The space capsule?
Yep.
Doesn't matter.
Same face.
The I remember being in the cinema, and when she comes back to Earth,
yeah,
and the thing's out drowning, she's about to be drowned.
Yeah.
After all this things happen to her, now she's about to drown just in water. Because
the pod lands in the lake.
Water falling in water. And then she gets out, and then she is swimming through the weeds.
Yeah.
And she gets caught in the weeds.
Yeah.
The entire cinema did a groan. Dead set. Like, this is borderline ridiculous.
Oh,
but I liked the movie. I thought it was good.
I thought she'd land. I was wondering where she had landed.
Oh, and I was thinking, like, crocodiles or something.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, something's definitely going to kill her.
Oh, I just thought, if a crocodile jumped out of the water and just took her alive, I would go... Thank you.
That's where you should end it.
Thank you. All right. Anyway, we really did digress there. No, it is the anniversary, the 20th anniversary of the Bunnet, Fergus McCann, saving our club from liquidation and administration. I just thought we could spend a bit of time reminiscing like you would LRB. Now you can't, Callum, because you were...
Two.
But you might not even been...
No, you weren't even born.
Yeah, it was 1992.
94.
94. Oh,
sorry. That's 20 years.
20 years.
Sorry.
You do the math pre.
How old am I, Dad?
Well, I'll be 21,
okay,
so...
92.
92.
So I was 2 years old.
You physically wouldn't have known what was going on.
I clearly
sorry,
know
that was
more
my
about
fault.
That
was my fault. I started all of that. I got you all completely fucked up by picking the right.
I wasn't fucked up. I was fine.
Yeah, whatever. Yeah.
So my question was to both of you was, when did you first realise that this was such a big deal? For my financial issues. Is that almost correct?
Almost, yeah. You've written out here.
No, what was... Shut the fuck up. What was the... At one point, did you realise... Because obviously, we didn't have internet. We didn't have, Twitter, those sorts of things.
Yeah.
At what point did you realise, holy shit, this club is about to go bust?
Okay, so the only...
Probably when it was all over and done with.
Well, the thing was...
you've told me the story before.
Well, we... The funny thing was is that we got... The only way we got communication from the club was every Wednesday, exactly 7 days late, the Celtic View arrived, because Dad used to subscribe to the Celtic View. And because it was, and as those days were referred, it was Pravda, so it was the mouthpiece of the communist Soviet state, you didn't know anything was going wrong. As front page of that was concerned, it was all hunky-dory, and they made out the rebels... And we'll come up to that, defining that word in a moment. But the Fergus McCann and Dempsey and all these kind of guys as these sort of band of outsiders that have no place in trying to come out and take over our club. But much similar to what Rangers fans felt during the demise of their club, because they were probably getting spun bullshit. They were getting spun bullshit, basically, by both the club and the media arm of the club, which is the press.
The Sun.
The Sun and the Herald and the Scotsman and everything else, the Mail. But, so, yeah, for us in Australia, it was difficult because we really didn't know what was going on. But to understand the magnitude of what was going on was... Years ago, there used to be a program on... I don't even know if SBS still have it, but at 7 o'clock after the news, it was World Sport with Les Murray. And their opening story was a sort of a 15-minute piece, which obviously had been done by someone in the UK, on what was going on behind the scenes at Celtic Park and the whole Celts for Change movement and the financial woes that the club's in and all that kind of stuff. So that's when Dad and I kind of looked at each other and went, ah, right, there's something more to it than just... But and also, you know, on the telephone, you could, you know, call back to Scotland, you got a sense that there was other shit going on, but I don't think we realised how big it was. And the fact that it had made Australian television news, albeit SBS, suggested to us that this was... the club was in some serious trouble and something drastically had to be done about it. That was my recollection. I don't know, Fraaank, if you got anything different.
Yeah, I just remember finding out about it when it was basically too late because of that. Even though that sort of war behind the scenes had been going for 2 years, you know, Fergus had been trying to gather support and votes and stuff like that for 2 years and meeting with the board, we still didn't get any information. You know, it's like...
Yeah.
In the early 90s, we
got... The internet was in its infancy there.
Yeah, like, and it was no social media, so...
Well, Al Gore hadn't invented it yet.
No.
That's right.
Allegedly.
So, you know, it was like one of those really bad stories you didn't want to hear about, and thankfully it ended up all right. So when we did hear about it, it was good news. So.
Yeah.
When did you know, do you remember when you found out that the club was okay?
The next day... I'd heard, I can't remember how, someone might have called Dad from Scotland or maybe Uncle Joe had found out or something, but we'd heard that that the club was 8 minutes away from the bank coming in and saying, right, we have to appoint some administrators here.
Yeah.
Because you can't settle your debts, your overdraft. And McCann walked up with £7-8 million and said, there you go. And even then, we still really didn't know, like, we really didn't know who this...
Well, there's a lot of Scots animosity... towards him when he first started and even when he left the club from certain sections of the
I mean, and that's a whole different story which we could extrapolate about today, but I know that certainly when he walked into the stadium and basically got the Kellys and the Whites to hand over the reins to the club and give him the authority to go to the bank and put in the $7 million to deal with the overdraft, there was thousands of people at the front
stadium. Actually would make a fantastic movie.
Yeah.
Because
they've talked about making a movie.
That period, whether you make a movie about the 7 days or the 7 months or the 2 years before,
yeah,
sensational movie. The drama that those, you know, the guys, all that stuff working behind the scenes, you know, ringing people up, Celtic supporters, give me your votes.
Tiny little, community halls and things.
Yeah, literally getting the first 40% of shareholders to give them the votes.
Yeah.
Thinking it's going to be a breeze, and then from there to getting the 51%, thinking, shit, we can't do this.
Yeah.
It's not going to happen.
Yeah.
You know? Amazing.
That book, I know what the book's called now, I completely forgot in the last 3 minutes, Rebels in Paradise, I think it was,
right.
Which documents the whole campaign, essentially, from way to go.
Yep.
And that's when I think I read that when it first... That's when you like say came out like a year later, and I thought when you read that you went, oh right, this was a significant campaign, and they were meeting in cemeteries outside Belfast, and you know there was a woman that had who had held a certain amount of shares from she was the granddaughter or the great granddaughter of one of the founders. And the shares had been in her family since 1887. And she handed them over to Fergus McCann. I mean, this, you know, monumental moments in the club's history happening in the lounge rooms of, you know, Celtic royalty. Not to want to use the word royalty, but you know, it was significant. And you're right, that's Hollywood right there.
Mm.
You know, sport, Hollywood tries to fabricate drama, but sport.
Yeah. Yep.
Creates
it. Transcends, doesn't it?
Every day, you know? Mm. And that there, and the fact that it came down to minutes.
It was the original, you know, what politics are trying to do now, which is like, you know, like ground support type of thing. It was almost the original way of doing that, you know?
It was a form of community organising in.
To, you know, one to one people and saying, this is what they're doing, this is what we want to do.
Yep.
And trying to give them an alternative, you know?
Yep.
And there was someone last night on Twitter had said when we were on our way back from the Greyhounds, in which we won $160 on a horse. Did it again.
And he'd been calling it all day, horse.
I said it about four
the
times.
Little horses.
To the guy who's in charge of it. And what a horse. This what horse that I got. Fuck, stop saying horse. Dog. One of the dogs, Celtic coin that got us $160. But someone on Twitter last night after, Callum, you had tweeted, and I'm just trying to find it. Celtic, God bless Fergus McCann, hashtag the Rebels have won. To which...
I thought it was a fairly innocuous tweet.
Yeah, I know. Someone took umbrage with... his name is Zombies Are Nuts, is his hashtag, and his real name is Pep. And he said, what Rebels? And made the point that it was real Celtic fans, it wasn't Rebels. And I thought about engaging on him, but I didn't bother because it's going to become.
Well, they had their own. Then someone else jumped in and had their own little conversation.
But I think it's worth noting now, because we've got microphones and he hasn't.
That you're a fucking idiot.
That was bullshit. Look, because there is, if you look at it, the definition of the word rebels is someone rebelling against the orthodoxy of what was going on. The orthodoxy was the Kellys and the Whites running a club into the ground. And they had approached Fergus McCann and Dempsey and a group of other businessmen who had Celtic's interests at heart, approached the mainstays, the people who run the club, and said, look, we want to come here and help you. And they've gone, no, we don't want this because we've run the club, we're custodians, fuck off. So they have rebelled against. It's a form of change. They sought change. So whether you want to have an argument about whether they're rebels or not, I don't really care. But I just think that it should be, for the record, recognised that there was a sense of rebellion against what was happening in the club. And it worked on two levels. The first level was that there was a social movement amongst the community of the Celtic support in Scotland and throughout the world, essentially, but focused on the west of Scotland. And that they brought about pressure from a grassroots level, sort of all the protests...
in the ground, outside the ground.
Yeah, absolutely, consistently for 2 years. And that, and gathering momentum and information and communication, all that kind of stuff.
And more importantly, with that as dispersing that information to more and more people as well.
Yeah. So that's powerful stuff. However, it would not have... Nothing would have happened if it wasn't for Fergus McCann.
And put the money in.
Yeah, exactly. But Fergus McCann bringing the money in wouldn't have happened if it wasn't for the support as well. Mm. And that's why it should be recognised that it wasn't just Fergus McCann and it wasn't just the support, but it was the unification of two shared mutual objectives of a grassroots campaign and a financial and legal battle that took place as well, and that's why it was so successful. And that's where I think the Huns fell down, is that there was no coordinated effort between.
And yet, it's so much easier today to do that.
Yeah.
Well, one of the main reasons that this has happened to them and will continue to happen to them is because they are the establishment club. They refuse to believe that their club could and would die.
Yeah.
Whereas we, as a supporting group, didn't have that mentality.
Yeah.
We knew that if we didn't look after the club, or if the people didn't look after the club, there was a real possibility, and there was a chance that this would have happened.
Yeah.
Because Celtic has never been welcome in Scotland, truly welcome in Scotland, and the supporter group has never fully been welcome into that community.
Yeah. That's the number one thing, but behind that, we had a guy who actually was only interested in the future of Celtic.
Mm.
No other. There was no agenda. There was no, this is a Hollywood script and I'm going to make $50 billion out of it.
Yeah.
Although, the negative Celtic supporters say, well, he actually did make money. Yeah. But he spent 80% of his wealth.
Yeah.
Put that on the table. They could have went belly up. There was no assurance that that was going to work.
Yeah. That's a good point as well, because... he put his money where his mouth is, and he made money. That's not no question that. But he made money over a relatively long term strategy, with a 5 year plan.
Under conditions.
Whereas these guys, he built the stadium, blah blah blah. Whereas these guys, it's short term. It's like investment banks do. It's all about short term profit, putting their money in quickly, getting out as quickly as possible.
Yeah.
So, good on him for making money. He deserved to make money because for 5 years. He put in a strategy which everyone knew about.
Yeah. And he's a good guy. That's the difference between him and what this other guy at Rangers has just done by lending them this...
$1.5 million or something.
It's going to save them somehow.
Yeah.
But, the conditions that he's set, he's going to be buying more shares off them, for a cent, basically.
Yeah. It's disgusting.
It's a bad guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it's no, it's fine because that's the type of people that attract.
Yeah. It's a loan shark existence now.
And that's fine. And I don't give a shit anymore.
And I think that McCann was always very upfront and transparent with what he did. He said, I will do this for five years. This is the money I will put in. This is the money that I will take out. I will build you a brand new stadium and I'll set the club up financially to be secure going forward. And he did. Everything he said he would do, he did.
Won the league as well.
Yeah.
There's a good article.
And then he got booed when we looked at
that. Yeah. Which is great that he's coming back for next year. Do you want to feel the flag?
Even though
we haven't won the league yet?
Well, what happened was when we... you asked me what happened or with McCann?
I just thought... Because he's coming back for the first game of the season next year to unfill the league flag.
Here comes that chopper again.
Even though we haven't won it. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's a bit cocky, but whatever. Fuck it.
It's the way he went about it, isn't it? It was clear. It was transparent.
Yeah.
Like the quote that when he first met David Lowe, who was Fergus's accountant figure man.
Yeah.
He flew to Canada to see Fergus, and Fergus said, "Who are you?"
Who did this, sorry?
David Lowe.
Okay, right. Yep.
He was doing the background stuff.
Yeah.
Fergus said to him, "Who are you? Where are you from and what do you want?" That was it. That was the intro to the meeting.
Yeah.
No bullshit. Mm. No fluffing all, Let's talk. What do you want to do? And that's when, he's presented the situation.
Yeah.
And that's what he's like,
Yeah.
Here's my plan. And you've got to understand, at that time, the team was shit. The crowd were getting less and less.
Yeah, they were fuck
like,
all turned up.
I think it was like 15,000 average.
Yeah.
And £7 million in the 90s is a lot of money.
The board's idea at the time was just to borrow more money.
Yeah.
That was their idea. And we had a ground that literally was like...
Ancient.
10 times worse than Old Breaks now.
Mm.
So... It was not looking good.
Yeah,
I don't know a lot of the history with this, but with the Kellys and the Whites, they obviously were financially, they were a wealthy families back in the day, and I mean they didn't want to put their own money in the club. Was that what the thing was?
That was the supposed story, but apparently in truth they weren't that rich because when they were asked to put money in, when the bank said to them, "We need personal guarantees," they went, "Well, we don't actually have any wealth that we can give as a guarantee." Yeah. And that was the problem.
Yeah.
So that was where Fergus had the one over them,
yeah?
Well, I have. I can guarantee that on this day I'll come in with $1 million as a security, and 4 days later when you want the other five, I'll be here with that five.
Yeah.
They can't do it. I can do it.
Yeah.
I mean, it really does sound like when Craig White came in and bought the club with borrowed funds. That's what that's, because he didn't have any money.
Yeah.
He's amazing.
And the other thing about that 8 minutes, that's when this David Lowe was there. He was saying, they were in the Bank of Scotland, got the draft, because this is not before internet banking.
Yeah.
The money had to be sent into the Bank of Scotland. They got the bank draft, walked with that to the other bank where they had to go and present it.
Yeah.
And the guy said, "I looked up at the bank and then the clock of the bank went, 8 minutes to 12. We've just made it."
It's nuts, isn't it?
Mm.
And that's the stuff a movie's made of.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just...
There's a great romance around that particular time as well. And there is a bit of a, and that's... You could even go... The movie would have to go to when he got booed and stuff. That would be a part of it.
Yeah.
And then... And
they've got the perfect...
Now coming back...
Bad guy, haven't they?
Yeah.
The Huns spending, for every 5 cents we were sending, they were spending most of Scotland's tax money.
It's a pretty amazing story, and I think it's great that the club have recognised the anniversary.
And it's good that the support will now have the chance to rectify behaviour.
Yeah, and they're talking about a statue too, aren't they?
Yeah.
On the North Stand.
It has to be done.
Yeah.
Well, the Celtic Way is now getting... done, so they've demolished the school.
Yep,
school's been done, and they're already putting in the plants and stuff. Like, it's been really quick.
Did you see someone's Twitter the other day? They'd done a cartoon of Celtic Park and where the underground goes. It literally, guy's drawn up, the underground is literally under the entrance of Celtic Park.
And he's got one way, so he's got two different ways. One way to Belfast, and one way to the shin phone offices or something like that. Right. Like it's, yeah.
Oh, okay.
That's brilliant.
They apparently got Jeff Kennett in to tell him how to knock the school down because he's had such experience.
Yeah.
Plenty of experience.
Nice. Yeah.
Thank you.
people are going, who the fuck is Jeff Kennett?
I don't know.
Who does he play for?
Yeah, so the school's getting knocked down. That's great.
Well, it's been knocked down.
But that won't... Celtic Way won't be ready for the Commonwealth Games, though, will it?
It's supposed to be. That was the whole idea.
Yeah, it will be. I think so, yeah.
All right.
Well, it has to be because...
I can't see it happening.
Well, there has to be something better than what it is because it's all closed off now. The whole front of the stadium is pretty much closed off.
Commonwealth Games aren't till... It's still a bit off.
They're this year, though, aren't they?
No. Well, not the World Cup. Can't be the same time as the World Cup.
Yeah, they are.
Well, that's not going to happen.
It's
I have no idea. I think it is this year.
It is this year. It's 2014. The World Cup.
I thought it was.
The World Cup is always the same year as the Commonwealth Games.
Right.
I think parts of the stadium aren't going to be finished in time, but they it might not be finished, but they have to. There was a picture the other day. There's construction everywhere in front of the stadium. They're hardly going to allow that to happen. I would say.
Well, they better get the move on. I mean, if FIFA been around to check it? Jesus. There's another junket. What are you doing here? I just thought we'd come and have a look.
Are you looking it up, Prefontaine?
Yeah, I am.
Yeah, you're right, it's 2014.
Talk about yourself.
Well, September.
Their website is Glasgow 2014.
So that's September.
I certainly hope it is in 2014.
They're just using Celtic Park for the opening ceremony, that's it. And then...
23rd of
July. And obviously football games.
23rd of July to the 3rd of August. There's no football in the
Commonwealth. Oh, that was my next question.
But there's touch rugby, and that's going to be played at the Bigot Dome.
So what's playing? We're being played at Parkhead.
Just the opening ceremony.
Oh, that's good.
Holds more.
Well, plus we've had games, haven't we? The league all started.
Oh no.
August.
It'll be interesting to see
week after
what happens when they flag the Butcher's flag over at Parkhead.
Oh no, that's going to give us shits. Just quietly. Anyway. Rightio, should we wrap this up?
Let's do it.
Are we done?
And dusted.
Who have we got next? Anyone? Anyone?
That's on my phone.
Well, who have we got? I'm sure we'll beat them. That's the take-home message. Don't forget you can follow us on Twitter at Rhebel Phodcast RH.
Kilmarnock Celtic on Saturday the 15th.
All right.
Which is also our... Party extravaganza.
St. Patrick's Day extravaganza.
When is the extensions happening here, by the way? I heard you're having 1,000 people.
Yeah. It's got to be tight.
You're going to have to extend out that balcony, mate.
It's got to be
tight. Is all the stuff here that you bought, or is it in the office?
That must be a Friday night game.
Yeah, it's Saturday. It's like 7:15 in the morning or something.
Yeah, it's a Friday night game.
Awesome.
I love those games.
You could start. You could start the party early.
Yeah.
That's actually a really good idea.
Finish by about 2.
God, we'll be fucking... We'll be dying.
We'll be steaming. Right, Killy, away. That's good. We'll be back again soon. Thank you for your patience, our listeners out there. Sorry to have gone away so long, but it's good to be back and having a chat about the football club. And we all hope you have a good week. And in the meantime, hail, hail.
Hail.
Ciao.